طيب، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. إن شاء الله today we continue our class about تفسير سورة البقرة. And I don't know if we'll share the presentation from our sister there. جزاكم الله خير، ما شاء الله، بارك الله فيك. So today we'll talk about the verses from 11 till 16. And today we are changing our way of this class because you see at the beginning when we were talking about the three groups about the believers, the disbelievers, and then the hypocrite. We in fact discussed about every group in more detail. So we did not stick to the verses as the way, the classic way of tafsir when the ulama, the scholars, people who are teaching tafsir, they take it verse by verse. Why? Because as I said, we've been talking about three groups. So it was maybe more beneficial to shed more light about the characteristics of each group, like when we talk about the believers at the beginning, al-muttaqin, and we talk about their characters that they believe in the ghaib, the unseen, and what does it mean, the unseen, and about the importance of salah, and about zakah, and giving charity and spending from their earning. And then we move to talk about the disbelievers. We talk about what does it mean to disbelieve, what types, different types of disbelief. There is shirk and there is kufr. And we talk about many causes and reasons that may push people away from the truth and from the light of the deen, the light of the guidance. And we talk about this in detail. Last week also, we talk about the hypocrites and we talk in detail about some of their characteristics, why they choose this way, deceiving themselves. And today, inshallah, we move to the next ayat. And from now on, we will talk about verse by verse. And then after one or two verses, we'll try to derive some of the lessons, some of the benefits that we learn from these verses. So the first ayah today, which is ayah number 11, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, and this, as we said, it is continuous for previous class, which talk about whom? About the hypocrites. And وَإِذَا قِيلَ لَهُمْ لَا تُفْسِدُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ قَالُوا إِنَّمَا نَحْنُ مُصْلِحُونَ. The meaning of this verse, and when it said to them, to whom? To those hypocrites, those that was mentioned in the previous ayah, those who have sickness in their heart. Do not cause corruption in the land or in the earth. They say, this is the response will be, we are but reformers. We are reformers. We are trying to do, you know, better and goodness. Subhanallah. So let's take this great verse, you know, word by word. When it is said to them, now it is said to them, it didn't say who are those who are saying this advice or giving this advice. It when it said to them, someone not known here, the subject was not identified, who is the one who is telling them or advising them. And why the ayah mentioned this? It was easy to say it when the believers say it to them. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, out of his wisdom, he make it open. Why? Because people, they get, you know, these people and others, they get advices from different sides, from different sources. Even sometimes from wise people who are not believing. They will tell them, well, this is good, look nice. But they will not follow it. As we say, you know, nowadays, you know, you see some people, they are not Muslim, they are not believers, but they talk in very just way. They show some of the beauty of Islam. They are just. So they encourage people to read and learn about Islam, about the guidance of God, about the revelation that was sent to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So this ayah said, when it said to them, to those people who are ignorant, those people who are hypocrite, those people who disbelieve. But here specifically, we are talking about whom? About the hypocrite. Why? Because it's continuous for the previous ayah. So what is the advice that was given to them and come to them from different sources, either from believers, from prophets, from wise people, even from their educators? What is this advice? It is, don't cause corruption. This is, لا تفسدوا الأرض. لا. This is nahi. Stop. Don't do it. Cause corruption. Now, what is the meaning of corruption? You know, the corruption is the change of the thing from the original shape, which is good, to become spoiled. Like, for example, when you have an, you know, when you pick or take an apple from the tree, or orange, or banana, or whatever, and then you leave it outside for some time, it will be spoiled. We said fasadat. Fasadat, that means it's not good anymore. So this is the meaning, or the linguistic meaning of the word fasada, the change or the opposite of the goodness or the best or the normal way of any things. So with the salah, طيب. Let's take the definition of Imam Ibn al-Qayyim. Imam Ibn al-Qayyim said, when he talked about this tafsir, don't make corruption by what? By disbelief, by disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, by committing sins. Why? Because this is the corruption that will happen in this land, in this earth. And the people will pay the price for this corruption. Not only those who did it, but even people around them. Sometimes they pay this price. As Aisha radiallahu anha, when she heard the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said that when the corruption, that there's been too much corruption, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala punish the whole people. So Aisha radiallahu anha said, O Prophet of Allah, how about those good people? There are some good people, but we know that when is the earthquake or any calamity that's come, you know, or happen, it will cover everyone. It will not identify, you know, believer and disbeliever. But everyone, later on, he will be accountable for what he did. But the corruption is, in fact, is the reason, the cause of the destruction of the earth. And there is no more corruption than disbelief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the major sin, disbelieving in Allah, or committing polytheism, you know, worshipping somebody, or calling somebody, or turn for legislation to someone other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When people, they follow this, there will be a lot of corruption. Why? Because you will never find just law, just legislation, more than what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed. And you can look now in the whole world. Whatever their background, whatever their philosophy, they try to make different laws, they change it, they reform it, they edit it once a while, but still, it's not the ideal one that fit all people. Maybe they will find they make some law that will serve their own people. But when it's this applied to people from other nations, from outsider, when they go outside of their country, they will not apply this law on themselves. Why? Because this is only for them. While the justice of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cover the believer and the disbelievers, cover everyone. Subhanallah. So this is the greatness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the disobedience, al-ma'siyah, is this is one of the main corruption that will destroy the land. So this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he mentioned about Fir'aun, what he said, قال عز وجل الآن وقد عصيت من قبل وقد عصيت قبل وكنت من المفسدين. This is Surah Yunus. When he, at the time of dying, he said, now I am a Muslim. So Allah عز وجل said to him, now you said that you are Muslim after you are in your way to die and you had disobeyed him, disobey Allah عز وجل before and were one of the corrupter. Before he was a corrupter. So, Fir'aun was the one who is corrupter. So, the disbelief is, this is the example or the clear example or action of corruption. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ يُؤْمِنُ بِهِ وَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ لَا يُؤْمِنُ بِهِ وَرَبُّكَ أَعْلَمُ بِالْمُفْسِدِينَ. The verse also in Surah Yunus, Surah Yunus, verse number 40, it said this, and of them or among them are those who believe in it, believe that's mean in the Quran, and of them are those who don't believe in it. And after this ayat, Allah Azza wa Jalla said, and your Lord is most knowing of the corruptors. And that's those who disbelieve, they are the real corruptor in this land. طيب. And when we talk about land or earth, you see, because there's two ways to understand this ayah. Either the earth in general or the land, the community, the country, or certain land. So in the earth, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned that people from all mankind will suffer if they make corruption in this earth. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in Surah Ar-Rum, Allah Azza wa Jal said, ظهر الفساد في البر والبحر بما كسبت أيدي الناس. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah Ar-Rum, corruption has appeared throughout the land and the sea, the whole earth. By what? By the reason of what the hands of people have earned, what they did. And here we'll mention the hand, because this is most of our actions done by the hand. But that's mean because of the practice, because of what the people do in this earth, corruption has appeared. And a good example, you see it now, you know, that everybody, they talk about it, believers and non-believers, Muslim and non-Muslim. What is it? This is what they call it, the globe increase in the heat or the climate change. And now they're trying to take certain procedure. They take the work in this to stop this. And as a result of this, what happened? A lot of earth slides, a lot of earthquake, and the mountains of ice now is melting, increasing the level of the sea or the ocean. A lot of corruption, subhanallah. Why? Because of the people, they didn't deal with the environment in the correct way. So dealing in the environment in the correct way, following the teaching of Islam, will protect this environment. Subhanallah. Islam, the first one who care about the environment, the air, there's no pollution in the air, the land. And even when we, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded us to eat or drink or use any of the resources, always he repeat again and again, وَلَا تُسْرِفُوا. Don't exaggerate. Don't spend more than what you need. Another ayah. إنه لا يحب المسرفين. Allah عز وجل doesn't like those who consume more than what they need or make corruption by extra or excessive usage of any things that they are not in need. So this is one of the sign of the corruption. So here, when you talk about the land, as we said, the earth in general, but also it is indifferent. The corruption is come in different way. Corruption in the community, in the social life. When we change the rules that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made for mankind. Allah Azza wa Jal created man and woman pair for what? To live in this world, to live in this land, to live in this earth, and to have children, and then they have families. Nowadays, there are some people who claim that they are reformers in the name of what they call it, human rights or individual rights. They make corruption by destroying the family. And this is what you can see it now everywhere. This new movement for making, there is no difference between men and women, or, dealing, subhanallah, in a way that it's not the normal or the known way that even Allah Azza wa Jal punish entire nation before. The people of Lut, they were destroyed because of this action. They call it, homosexuality or whatever. You see, when will be start to the destruction of the family, that no family, no man and woman, no husband and wife. And this is what the people are suffering from this corruption. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. So, if we talk about the earth here, when in connection to the hypocrite, what does it mean? I mean, what's the relation here? Don't make corruption in the land here, fil ard, because the hypocrite, at that time, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they work hard to stop the light of Islam, to stop the light of the revelation, to stop the spread of Islam. By what? By making deals with the enemy of Islam, like they go to the Jew, for example, Medina, and they make allies for them, and they tell them about them, the believers, and about their strength, and they work with them in different plan, and also allies with the disbelievers in Mecca, as they did in Ghazwat Al-Ahzab, the confederation, when they come from all around Arabia, they try to end the mission of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to stop Islam. This is the real corruption. Because just imagine, if they were succeed, that the whole world will live in darkness, as previous nation when they lost their teaching. But it is the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that Allah Azza wa Jal gave success and victory for this religion and protect this religion by the way of Allah Azza wa Jal. So when it's said to them, what is the response? They say what? They say, we are but reformers. We are not making corruption. As we said it, we are doing, try to apply human rights. Man or woman, they have the choice. If she want to go, the woman, she want to go with a woman. And if the man who want to go to a man and they have a relation, why we should interfere? This is their claim. Subhanallah. This is what they claim. And now many in many calls, in many of this slogan they do, they spread it in the name of what? Of reforming. And reforming. And this is what we see now. We see the effect of the reforms in the whole world. The corruption that people are suffering. Wars, conflicts, everywhere. And all it was led if you hear the news or if you follow reports, all this gathering all in one plane. We want to make peace. Where's the peace? Where is the peace now in the world? Look at the conflict everywhere. Where is the peace in the earth, where there are many refugees from different countries? They are running. Where is the reforming? Where is the meaning of peace and stability in this planet? It's not there, but they claim they do it. So this is not a new claim. It is from the time before. Everybody claims that he is of those arrogant people, of those who destroying the world. He claimed that he is making reform. Like Fir'aun. We know that Fir'aun, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned, that he, you know, make corruption in the land. But he and his advisor and his people around him, what they say? They claim that they are making reforming and accuse Musa alayhi salam and those who are calling people to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that they are one who make the corruption. Look at this. Fir'aun, what he said to Musa alayhi salam, he said, إِنِّي أَخَافُ أَن يُبَدِّلَ دِينَكُمْ أَوْ يُظْهِرَ فِي الْأَرْضِ الْفَسَادِ. This is Surah Ghafir, verse 28. He said, I fear that he, talking about Musa, will change your religion, you know, the religion of your forefathers, this is what you care about, or that he will cause corruption in the land. Musa alayhi salam came to form corruption. This is what always the corruptors, all those these people, they claim it, as they do today, these days. Now, what they say, what they are accused Muslim, they accuse them of backward. They, you know, barbarian because they apply the Quranic or the Islamic Sharia, Islamic law. They call them, they are extremists. They call them terrorists. Different labels. They label for the believers, for the Muslim. They try to push people away from Islam. But alhamdulillah, by the will of Allah Azza wa Jal, now people now have more knowledge. And they were enlightened about the truth of Islam, even with this very, very strong Islamophobia. This media tried to spread it all over the world. Everybody of these people, you know, they claim that he is a reformer. Look at Fir'aun, he said. He said, قال فرعون ما أريكم إلا ما أرى وما أهديكم إلا سبيل الرشاد. He said, the Pharaoh said, I don't show you except what I see. This is my view. This is my wisdom. This is my opinion, he said. And I do not guide you except to the way of right conduct. Claim reforming. Fir'aun. And how many Fir'aun nowadays we have in the world? Those superpower, they destroy the whole planet in the name of reforming. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala answered them. And he said, أَلَا إِنَّهُمْ هُمُ الْمُفْسِدُونَ. And questioned this man. Allah Azza wa Jal said, they are not the reform. It is they who are the corruptors. Will you move the slides? Next point, please. Yes. So Allah said, Azza wa Jal, he said, Ala innahum. Ala innahum. There is no doubt. Here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala turned attention that in reality, they are the one who are corrupter and questionability. It is they who are the corruptors. Please, next point, the slide. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, it is they who are the corruptors. They are the one. They are the one. Even they claim this. As we said, Fir'aun, for example, he claimed that he is, you know, reformer, but Allah Azza wa Jalla said about him, إن فرعون على في الأرض وجعل أهلها شيعا يستضعف طائفة منهم يذبح أبناءهم ويستحي نساءهم إنه كان من المفسدين. About the Pharaoh. Indeed, فرعون exalted himself in the land and made its people into faction. You know, he divided them different different classes. You know, there are servants, there are masters. So he said, oppressing a sector among them. He was oppressing the people, the children of Israel who were in Egypt, slaughtering their newborn babies. And you know the story, and we'll come inshallah to this in the future. Sons. And keeping their female alive, you know, to use them in service. Indeed, he was of the corruptors. This is the real corruption. And then Fir'aun claimed that he is making reforming. So when the Quran talk here about the hypocrites of the time of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, emphasizing that they are the real corruptors. They are none else other than them. Why? Because they want to stop the light of Islam. طيب. Now let's take some lessons from these two verses. First one, that hypocrisy is the worst type of corruption. Hypocrisy is the worst type of corruption. Why? Because many people will be deceived by them. They think they are a believer. They think they are advisor. Some of them, they come in the form of preacher or teachers or sheikh. Subhanallah. But they may deceive people. So they are, this is why the Muslim should be very careful and should take his knowledge from authentic sources that known, you know, that they are following the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then the next point that we learn from this verse, we learn that the believers, they have the better understanding of the meaning of reforming. Why? Because reforming is not only in this life, but reforming for all aspects of life. And this is why the non-believer, they don't realize this. All they care is what? About this worldly life. And they forget about the hereafter. Also, we learn from this verse that it is not, you know, we should not just, you know, give anyone whatever he claims. That means claiming doesn't make the person always telling the truth. Maybe he claims something and he doesn't believe in it. Like the hypocrite, they say amanna, but they are not believers. So, or those, you know, what they call themselves, a human rights group sometimes, you know, they claim that they are making a reforming while they're making corruption. So it's not whoever say that he is, you know, reforming or making good, that's mean he truly is making good, maybe making the opposite. This is why Allah Azza wa Jalla said, أَفَمَنْ زُيِّنَ لَهُ سُوَ عَمَلِهِ وَرَآهُ حَسَنًا فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ يُضِلُّ مَنْ يَشَاءُ ويهدي من يشاء. This is Surah Fatir, verse number 8. Isn't the one who look at his conduct or action or his way that it is good? This is what he look at it. He thinks that it is good. While it's not. But it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who gives guidance to whom he wish or he want. طيب. The fifth point that we learn from this verse, it said that the person may make corruption and he may feel it. He may not feel it. This is what we learned from the word in the ayah who said, لا يشعرون, but they perceive it not. They perceive it not. So sometimes the person is doing something wrong and he will not feel it. He thinks that he's doing good. He doesn't feel the mistake that he's doing. till he paid a high price for that mistake. طيب. Now let's go to the next verse. وَإِذَا قِيلَ لَهُمْ آمِنُوا كَمَا آمَنَ النَّاسُ قَالُوا أَنُؤْمِنُ كَمَا آمَنَ السُّفَهَاءُ أَلَا إِنَّهُمْ هُمُ السُّفَهَاءُ وَلَكِنْ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. And when it said to them, believe as the people have believed, they say, should we believe as the foolish have believed? And question believe. It is they who are the foolish, but they know it. Now this is another, you know, characteristic of those hypocrites. Look, how do they respond to the Sahaba, to the Prophet first of all, to the Sahaba, to teachers, people who are telling them, why don't follow the right way? Why don't follow the truth? So what they said, and when it said to them, as we said before, here it was not mentioned who said it, to make it open. That means whenever they receive an advice from any source, and this advice said, believe as the people have believed. Believe in Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Believe in the Quran as those Sahaba. Look at those people. They were in Mecca. They were oppressed. They immigrated to Medina. They left everything behind them. Look to those people like Umar ibn Abu Bakr al-Siddiq. He was a wise man. Look at Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu. Radiallahu anhu, anhu Abu Bakr, anhu jami' al-Sahaba. Look at them. Those wise people. They believed, and all the Sahaba, what they will say? They will say, should we believe as the foolish have believed? So they accuse the believers, the Muslim, as foolish. And this is what we see it nowadays. Unfortunately, among some people who born as Muslim and live as Muslim, but because hypocrisy, you know, cover their heart, so they see anyone who is applying the sunnah in his life or following the teaching of Islam in his life, that he is foolish. He is not enjoying his life. You know, he lived and he feels that he is in, you know, 1,000 years back. Subhanallah. This is their feeling. This is their perspective or their view. They think they are the smart. They are the smarter than everyone else. And those people who are following the guidance of Allah, they are foolish. They are naive. Masakin. They are naive. They don't, you know, enjoy this life, this technology, everything in this world. This is their accusation. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about them. There's no doubt it is they who are the foolish. But they don't know. وَلَكِنَّهُمْ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. They are the foolish. They are the naive. Why? Because they don't think deeply about the purpose of their creation. They don't think deeply about what will happen for them after they leave this life. They think, you know, life only enjoyment of the pleasure of this world. And they leave behind them what they will face when they will be stand for judgment and accountable for what they did. So here you see that they deceived themselves. This is what we mentioned, you know, referring to the ayat from the beginning. وَخَادِعُونَ اللَّهُ وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَمَا يَخْدَعُونَ إِلَّا أَنفُسَهُمْ. Those who are, you know, staying away from Islam or accusing Islam and Muslim, or they think they are, you know, the one who people of understanding and people of wisdom, they are the real foolish because they don't think about what the purpose of their being and their existence. They don't think about the wisdom of the creation of this universe. And from this verse, my dear brothers and sisters, also we try to draw the following benefit or lesson. First of all, the hypocrite may not benefit from the da'wah, from preaching, from advice. Why? Because he believed that he is the smart one. And those people who advise him, they say, look, don't listen to him. They are just mutawwa. They are, you know, they don't live in this world. So as long as they don't appreciate and value the people of knowledge, they will never learn from them. They will never benefit from the advice. Always. This is why it's very important, you know, for the person that you know the value of the people of knowledge. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala praised the people of knowledge. يَرْفَعِ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مِنْكُمْ وَالَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْعِلْمَ دَرَجَاتٍ. Why? Because those are who are teaching people the knowledge of the deen, the knowledge of the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So if someone think that this sheikh or this alim or ulama, they are naive and they know nothing, how come you expect him that he will benefit from his teaching or from the education or his advice? They will never. This is why it said here, they will never. This is one thing that we know, that the hypocrite will never benefit from people or advisor. Also, we learn from this that those hypocrites, they are proud of themselves and they think they are wise while they are ignorant. So they don't know themselves really, the reality of themselves or their knowledge or their intelligence. They know nothing. But unfortunately, you know, they believe they are arrogant and they think they know everything while they know nothing. Also, we learn from this that, as it said here, that always this is the slogan they do in all generations. You see, from the time of the Prophet, they call the Sahaba, they are naive, they know nothing. The same thing that you see it nowadays in the media, in Islamophobia, when they accuse Muslim, they are ignorant. They know nothing about this world. You see, they live, you know, in old ages. They are barbarian. All take of all this kind of insulting against Muslim, especially the people who are calling to da'wah. Like, for example, you know, many of the non-believers and followed by a hypocrite, always they accuse those who are commanding good and forbidding evil, that they are oppressor, they are, you know, and this is why always they draw bad image about those who are calling to goodness and to stop evil. And subhanAllah, this is nothing new. All nations before, all nations, they accuse the prophets and their followers who are calling to the truth with the same thing. As Allah Azza wa Jal mentioned in Surah الذريات. قال عز وجل كذلك ما أتى الذين من قبلهم من رسول إلا قالوا ساحر أو مجنون. It is the same. محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم, don't worry about what they say. Never come before you a messenger to his people, except there are some people who will say about him that he is crazy, he is mad, or he is a magician. So they accuse. The same thing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَكَذَلِكَ جَعَلْنَا لِكُلِّ نَبِيٍّ عَدُوًا مِنَ الْمُجْرِمِينَ. Every prophet, he has enemies among those criminals. And those criminals, not they are only enemy for prophets, but also for the followers of the prophets who are carrying the teaching of prophets, same like those who are carrying the teaching of Islam and da'wah. The ayah that I just mentioned, which is in Surah Al-Dariyat, it said, similarly, there come not to those before them any messenger, except that they said a magician or madman. This is the claim. Also, we learn from this verse, my dear brothers, that anyone, in fact, anyone who doesn't believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he doesn't see the truth of Islam and the revelation after, if he was not, I mean, if he was have knowledge about it and he doesn't follow it, that's mean he is naive because he didn't choose for him what is good. This is why Allah Azza wa Jalla said, وَمَنْ يَرْغَبُ عَنْ مِلَّةِ إِبْرَاهِيمِ إِلَّا مَنْ سَفِهَ نَفْسًا. Allah said, and who would be averse to the religion of Ibrahim alayhi salam? He doesn't accept it. Except one who makes a fool of himself. Fool of himself. So subhanAllah, those foolish people, they think they are the wise and they continue to live in the darkness. طيب. Also, we learn from this verse that the real wisdom, the real knowledge is to believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to learn his teaching because he is the wise. He's the one who created us. He's the one who knows everything. He is the one who administered this whole universe and know how it's become good or not. And what is the thing that will spoil it or destroy it? So who is the real wise people? Those who take the wisdom from the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And in this also, Allah Azza wa Jal show you that he always defend the believers. In this verses, he defended the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and the Sahaba and the believers against this hypocrite. And same as he defended them, you know, by the word, also he defended them by the action, by giving them victories over their enemies whenever there have been any battles between the believers and the non-believers. And the last or the end of this ayah said, but they know not. So this is to show you how ignorant are those hypocrites because the truth is in front of them, but they are blind. They cannot see it. Right. Let's move now to the next verse, which said, وَإِذَا لَقُوا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا قَالُوا آمَنَّا وَإِذَا خَلَوْا إِلَى شَيَاطِينِهِمْ قَالُوا إِنَّا مَعَكُمْ إِنَّمَا نَحْنُ مُسْتَهْزِئُونَ. Look at them. And when they meet those who believe, they say, we believe. But when they are alone with their evil one, they say, indeed, we are with you. We were only mockers. We just deceive them. We don't believe. We just want to go to them, you know, when we are with them, just we show that, or this is the work of the hypocrites. So let's take it one by one. And when they meet those who believe, that's, you know, when the hypocrite, they go where the Sahaba, the Prophet, they go to the masjid, they go to the gathering of the believers. When they attend any gathering with the Muslim, you know, they come and show themselves they are believers, that even they attend Salah. Can you imagine? They go to the masjid. And this is what Allah Azza wa Jalla said, وَإِذَا قَامُوا إِلَى الصَّلَاةِ قَامُوا كُسَالَى. Oh, you know, they are not motivated from their heart, but they do it just to show. يُرَاءُونَ النَّاسِ. Allah said, وَلَا يَذْكُرُونَ اللَّهَ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا. Only remembering Allah, few, in front of the believers. When they leave, they forget the remembering of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when they sit with a believer, they say, we are like you. There's no difference between you and us. Why you don't, you know, trust us? We are a believer like you. Subhanallah. But the truth that when they are alone with their evils, وَإِذَا خَلَوْا إِلَى شَيَاطِينِهِ, that means they are away from the believer. They show their real face. They show by saying, we are not a truly believer. We just, you know, try to get some benefits. And this is what some people are do every, in all generations. You will find some people, they come to Islam, or they claim they are a Muslim, or they embrace Islam, not because they believe in Islam. They are hypocrites. but for certain benefits. For example, somebody, he loves a Muslim woman, he wants to marry her, he will say, ah, I cannot marry her unless I become Muslim. So he claimed that he wants to be a Muslim. This is one reason. Other day, for example, he want to make business with some Muslims, with Muslim. They have good capital. They have good investment. They want to invest with them. So how can he try to show that he is very sincere and honest? So he showed that he's a Muslim. This is the way of the hypocrite in all times. But believe me, let me just here mention one important thing, especially for the da'iyah and for the general Muslim. That doesn't mean we have the right to judge the people or their heart. So if someone comes and embraces Islam, Allah only, the only one who knows what is in his heart. Our duty, as we will learn from the Quran and the Sunnah, we deal him as he appeared to us. He said, I want to be Muslim. Okay, welcome. Islam like this and like that. You are convinced? You said the Shahada? I will not try to investigate and dig to see what his real intention. Because what is in the heart, judged only by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But here the ayats show you that this is one of the way of the hypocrite. They show that they are believers and we are the believers. But when they go to their people, they deny it. Why? Because he feels that his people, they don't like him. If he embraces Islam, becomes Muslim. He said, no. Don't believe that I become Muslim. I just believe, show that I am Muslim so I can get some benefit, some profits by dealing with a Muslim. This is why they said, we are with you. We are not with a Muslim. We are with you. And this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said. And then they said, إِنَّمَا نَحْنُ مُسْتَهْزِئُونَ. We were only mockers. We just deceived them. So we get advantage of this. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about them in the next ayah, اللَّهُ يَسْتَهْزِئُ بِهِمْ وَيَمُدُّهُمْ فِي طُغْيَانِهِمْ يَعْمَهُونَ. They think they deceive Allah. They deceive the believers. In fact, they deceive themselves. But Allah mocks them and prolongs them in their transgression while they wander blindly. In fact, they don't know that they are deceiving themselves. So how did Allah Azza wa Jal, subhanahu wa ta'ala, mock them? By leaving them believe their lie. They make a lie and they believe about it. What is this lie? The lie, they deceive themselves by thinking that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't know what's in their heart. And they think they are deceiving the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the Sahaba. So they lived in this. So, and as Islam taught us to deal with them as a believer or as a Muslim. So this is the way that Allah as well gave them chance. And this is why my dear brothers said in the next ayah, and prolong them in their transgression. Why? Give them. And this is why, my dear brother, it is very important to understand that when the person is disbelieving or a hypocrite or even a Muslim, when he is committing many sins, and then with all sin that he is committing, he gets success, he increases in his wealth, he gets what he wants. This is not a good sign for him. Not good sign. Some people, they said, and unfortunately, some ignorant Muslims said, look at the so-and-so. I am praying, fasting, giving charity, and I'm poor, I'm in troubles. And look at this man. He doesn't pray. He doesn't go to the masjid. And look, he is successful. He good in business every time he gain in his business. This is not a good sign for him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give him. But when he take him, it will be a surprise for him. Because Allah azza wa jal will make him pay for all the sins that he committed. And so this is the way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala maqdim. The same thing, you know, as we mentioned before, in the day of judgment. In the day of judgment, those hypocrites, they will come along with the believers. They think, oh, we, at dunya, we were with them, we were able to marry among them, we inherit, we do business with them, we deceive them. And now it's in the hereafter, we are with them. And then when they come to that place when it is very darkness, only there's the light of the faith that will show and come from whom? From those who believe. So those believers, the true believers, Allah Azza wa Jalla give them light, they walk. They can see their way. For those hypocrites, they will not find this light. Why? Because they didn't take it in this world. So they look around, it's darkness, and then they will call upon the believers, hey, wait for us. We were with you. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they will tell them, go back and find light for them, for yourself. And they will not find. So from this ayat, we learn, we conclude by this lesson that we learn from this ayat. First of all, to show you, yani those hypocrites, they don't even respect themselves. Why? Because they come in two faces. They don't have the courage to truly reflect the reality of themselves. And also, to show you that whoever think that he deceived Allah or he's deceived the believers, in fact, he's deceiving themselves. And also we learn from this that sometimes a person, when he's committing sin and he continue in the sin, this sin may cover his heart and may cover his eyes, so he will not see the light of the truth. And this is why, remember, we talk about it before when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, كَلَّا بَلْرَانَا عَلَىٰ قُلُوبِهِمْ مَكَانُ يَكْسِبُونَ, when we talk about kufr. And we said one of the reasons of disbelief that when the sins cover the hearts, so it become at the beginning as a hypocrite, and then it will turn to very clear disbelief. The last verse, أُولَٰئِكَ الَّذِينَ اشْتَرَوُوا الضَّلَالَةَ بِالْهُدَىٰ فَمَا رَبِحَتْ تِجَارَتُهُمْ وَمَا كَانُوا مُهْتَدِينَ. Now this is the conclusion. This is the conclusion about these people. What's action they are doing? What is their goal? Their goal, they think they are, you know, winning or gaining. So Allah Azza wa Jalla gave them the example. His example of a person who's doing business and trading. That means he gives something and gets something, you know, from the other side. He said, those who are the one who have purchased error, it's like a trader who bought something which is for what? And what's the price for this? That he give up guidance. So Allah said, those are the ones, that means those hypocrites who bought and who took the misguidance, the darkness, and they think they are buying something which is good for them. But in fact, what they get from themselves, only what they get is the darkness. They lost. They will lose in this life and in the next one. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, in exchange for guidance, look to this exchange. Just imagine, you know, a person, when he go and pay money or pay something, he pays something that, you know, at least for value of what he paid. But those are opposite. They pay the good and they get the bad. They pay that, you know, they push away the truth and they get the false. So what mentality is this? Why? Because they will never be guided, because they get lost. فَمَا رَبِحَتْ تِجَارَتُهُمْ, and will never be guided. Why? This is what they call it al-amah. Amah, blinding of the heart. there's a difference between al-ama wal-amah. At the end there is ha, amah. Al-amah is the blinding of the sight. Wal-amah is the blinding of the heart. This is why Allah Azza said, وَإِذَرُمْ فِي طُغْيَانِهِمْ وَمَا كَانُوا مُهْتَدِينَ. في, they are, in fact, في عمه ما كانوا مهتدين. طيب. And let's now finish with some of the benefits and listen from this ayah. This to show you how foolish are these people, the hypocrite, who give up the truth and buy the false. And also to show you how much they are sinking in their the darkness of the misguidance they care about. And also we learn from this, my dear brothers and sisters, that the Muslim should be very careful that not doing sometimes he think that he's doing something correct, but it is not right. As people who are doing bid'ah, there are some Muslim, unfortunately, who are very sincere, but they are doing bid'ah. Some of this bid'ah, they may get them out of Islam, like the bid'ah of going around the graves of some of the righteous people. And when you ask him, say, this is waliullah, he tell you, this is the wali, this is the one who helped me. And he insists in this. He thinks that he is in the straight path, but he is not. So this is the problem when the person, he doesn't know that he, what he's doing is right or wrong. This is why, my dear brothers, always we say, brothers and sisters, always we say that, when you do any action, when you think about anything, don't just, you know, use your feeling or ask someone what is his opinion. Take this in front of where and judge it according to what? The Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. If it was approved by the Quran, encouraged by the Quran and the Sunnah, then this is the good. If it's not, then it is not. Why? Because the criteria, the Furqan, is the Quran. The criteria, the standard that we should turn to know the truth from the false and the guidance from the misguidance, it's not what we imitate or what see people are doing. No. What the Quran say and what the Prophet ﷺ teach. Because people, if you just follow what the people are doing, they will misguide you. And this is why Allah Azza wa Jalla said in the Quran, وَإِن تَتَّبِعْ أَكْثَرَ مَنْ فِي الْأَرْضِ يُضِلُّوكَ عَنْ سَبِيلِكَ. If you follow most of the people around, then you will see that what? They will misguide you from the way of Allah Azza wa Jalla. So it is very important to turn to Islam. طيب. Also, we learn from this that the standard or the scale for the real profit or loss is what? As we do nowadays, it is either to believe or not, because the real success, the real gain, when the person gain his salvation. And the real loss, the one who lose his soul in the hereafter and was thrown in the hell. And lastly, we learn from this that those people, in fact, who, you know, take the characteristic of hypocrite and go with them and listen to them, they could be misguided and they will be sink in that darkness. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increase us in the knowledge of the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because this is the light that will save us and show us the way, and never ever we follow our own desire or what we think it is nice or good. Never. We follow only what was revealed to us from the Quran and the Sunnah. Barakallahu feekum wa jazakum Allahu khayran. I hope that may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala benefit us. I pray that may Allah azza wa jal benefit us all from whatever we read, whatever we see, whatever we say, whatever we hear, and make this knowledge testify for us in the day of judgment, not against us. Testify for us by what? By practicing this knowledge that we learn from the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Jazakumullah khair wa barakallahu feekum. And we stop here. And sorry for take all this time, but alhamdulillah that we are cover, we are able to cover all this basis. Any question? Anyone have question? He raise his hand, and our admin, may Allah reward her, she will give him a chance to unmute his or her mic.
Assalamu alaikum. I just want to ask question. It's regarding, what if it's okay to parent to say no for someone who is asking, wanted to marry her daughter, but he is not yet a Muslim, and they said he will talk shahada before. Is it okay to say no if the man is not yet a Muslim?
Yes, at the beginning, if he's not a Muslim, they should never make proposal for marriage from the beginning. See, this is the problem, unfortunately, that some Muslim girls, especially nowadays, because of this, media, as you know, the communication, they meet someone who is not a Muslim, maybe through different of these social media. And then they as they said, they fall in love. And then they said, okay, you want to marry me, or come and become Muslim. This is not the real approach. Because as we said, if some people, especially those non-Muslim, they think that it is just say this shahada and then you will be Muslim, or you will be allowed to marry a Muslim. In fact, we deceive them. We don't tell them the truth. Therefore, it is, should be very clear cut from the beginning. If one he come and said, I want to marry this lady, we tell him in Islam, it's not lawful for non-Muslim to marry a Muslim lady. Very clear from the beginning. If he said, I want to be a Muslim, he said, okay, fine, go ahead and learn about Islam and then practice Islam. And then when you become Muslim, then we can look at your proposal, not promise. It's very important. So he will take it seriously. See? And this is very important, because in this way, you can tell if this person truthful or he just want to say shahada just to marry this lady. So this is my advice. In fact, we don't start any proposal for anyone to marry a Muslim lady till he become Muslim, without promising from the beginning. What we do, we tell him in Islam, it's not lawful for a Muslim woman to marry a non-Muslim. That's it. And then let him decide. But unfortunately, nowadays, you find some girl, especially these days, they try to push, okay, go ahead, just say the shahada. And then they take him to Islamic center. They say, he's already said the shahada. And sometimes he doesn't know anything about this. So we should be very careful about this, because the outcome of this is really is not good. And from my experience with some of the problems that faced some of our sisters, they were suffering from this. I have, different stories for some Muslim women. Unfortunately, they were deceived by some of these people. They come and they said, they are Muslim. And then after they marry, and maybe they leave them even without divorce, and then they will say what? When they talk to them, they said, no, I wasn't really Muslim. I was just said the shahada to marry you. Why the Muslim lady put themselves in this situation? So I hope this is very clear, and we should teach, especially teachers, teach our girls that should be proud of your Islam. If someone approach or say that, don't ever give or try to get in touch with an unbelievers and then try to attract him to Islam just for the purpose of marriage. Barakallahu feek. Na'am.
Jazakallah
khairan, Sheikh. Okay, if there is no question, then we'll stop here and see you, inshallah. Tomorrow we have our fiqh class. We'll continue. Jazakallah khair. Assalamu alaikum. ورحمة الله وبركاته.